Real question, bro. How did you feel trying to tell us what you was going through at the time and how you truly felt?
I was shaking. My fingers were shaking.
What was your welcoming in moment to the family?
So actually, I got added by your mama. So I have got my eyebrows done in college. And she was like, I like your eyebrows, who did them? And so I told her. So then I think she said something to my daddy. So then my dad said something to my mom. Then my mom was like, you getting your eyebrows done, so what is it? And so I was like, are you gay or something? I was like, yeah. She was like, okay, tell your dad. He kind of just told me, hey, it's your sexuality, it's your business.
James never really said anything, but when you grow up with somebody, you just, you know, and I think I knew for myself personally before we even got out of high school.
I graduated.
Wait, college. What made you know? I wanna know.
We would play fighting games. James will always pick the girl character no matter what. You know, it was just little hints. That's what I say, you know, you grow up with somebody, you don't really care, because it's not what's important to you. As long as my brother's safe, he out there happy, that's all I really care about.
How did you feel trying to tell us what you was going through at the time and how you truly felt?
I was shaking. My fingers were shaking. I was just like, I'm gonna just say it, I'm just gonna go with it. Maybe saying it more often is kind of how you get into that comfortable mode. So by the time I told you, it wasn't as easy,
right?
But it became progressively easier.
Right, because we did spend a lot of time with each other, like every day.
You always just say, maybe I'll do it tomorrow, and I'll do it tomorrow. And it becomes like a series of like tomorrows and the next day and the next day.
You never get to it, right?
And I wish I did it sooner.
Do you feel like that you're making up for parts that you missed out? Like say while we were in school.
Dating and relationships, obviously. I've had my fun in college and things like that, but when it's like, you know, you make that full decision of like, okay, this is kind of what you're committed to, this is what your life is about. Being able to like have normal, healthy relationships, normal, healthy sexual relationships, obviously that's a new thing for sure. And I travel more, I see more, I'm not necessarily kind of tied to the hometown.
Yeah.
But I guess I'm just more vocal and more open about it, not necessarily afraid of like the repercussions of
right.
It. I think it's like the perfect time now.
Yeah, everything happened for a reason, bro. What do you feel like you can be authentically yourself?
Do I feel as if like I can always authentically be myself inside of the fraternity? Not necessarily, just because you don't have that type of representation. I've met brothers that, you know, they figure out the truth, they don't even offer to shake my hand. And at one point I had to let that go of like, damn, like this is like really like gonna affect me. So quite frankly, the most comfortable people that I was around were just people inside the community and things of that nature. I could kind of like distract myself with like the accomplishments and the achievements and the projects.
Right,
and
right.
You know, I was doing a lot of social justice stuff. I got a chance to be on a Senate campaign. But it was like in the sense of, I couldn't even be proud of those things because I felt as if it was like me kind of distracting myself from myself, you know?
So, you know, we always evolving, always growing. So if ain't nobody tell you, bro, proud of you, bro. Like, for real. Takes a lot of courage and confidence, bro.
Being a solo is no one's dream. No one walks in wanting to be a solo, at least. And because I did want that brotherhood, I think a part of me wanted to have that piece of safety too, to show that the people around me, and not to say I didn't have it, because I did have it within my chapter, but to have a line, it speaks differently. There's a deeper connection with that line and with that intentionality attached to it. That's why, if anything, when people try to challenge me and what I am and being in my organization, I'm like, one, I chose this and I chose to do it by myself. And I had to push myself to do this by myself. So I didn't have anybody to lean on. I didn't have a person to push me up when I wanna fall down. Being from Oklahoma and being from North Tulsa specifically, where the concentration of Black people is so concentrated, my family was my safe space. And though they didn't necessarily always have the language to make me feel comfortable in like the whole, when you got your hands out, I knew a part of it as I got older was them just wanting me to be safe, because I knew the world wouldn't necessarily be as accepting as they are of me. I even tell people, like, I don't need friends, I got 8 siblings. I don't And my siblings really do support and show up for me. And like, I didn't have friends like that growing up in high school or middle school. And so to go to Ronnie's houses and to be around my cousins, that was like my safe space.
You just, you want to create a safe environment for somebody, especially if they're your family member.
On the day that I was born black, I was also born a homosexual. They either believe in freedom and justice for all, or they do not.
What is manhood? What is masculinity?
Protect your family for one. Like anybody try to come and harm them, you step up and you be that protector.
My dad is kind of like the best man that I've ever met. It would be kind of remiss to say that, you know, there wasn't really openness to like vulnerability, you know, right. The emotional side, yeah. And things of that nature. Like it's kind of hard, you know, balancing that you might have more femininity in you than other guys that are just normal guys. But then it's like masculinity, or the definition of it is expanding. It's kind of limiting just to say I have to be tough and everybody can't be Atlas. Holding the world on his shoulders was a punishment. We should just try to take away the pressure of like, you know, you almost have to be perfect as a man.
It's not one dimensional.
After doing the real research, after looking at the people that I looked up to growing up, the Bayard Rustins, the Langston Hugheses, before I even knew they were Omegas, they were people that my dad kind of aligned around us, and they all spoke to that Omega spirit. But I still found ways to be myself. I naturally have a smart mouth. So I just knew anytime, just be authentic to myself. And if I'm authentic to myself and I feel like I'm showing up as what I think manhood is standing in your truth and being true to yourself. And people don't do that every day in this room. And so for me to have to live comfortably in myself and choosing to live comfortably in myself, for me, that's more manhood than most. To speak to that, I think it also speaks to the family aspect and showing up for my family, showing up for my community, showing up for the people that I want to serve.
So what I feel like you learned from me since 2018 till now?
What I've learned from you is just being unapologetic, but you do it with such like a confidence and kind of a swagger with it.
You always been a great leader. You was in the community. What you believed in, you believed in, and you spoke up about it. You was never afraid to speak on things that bothered other people.
We've all done a lot of great things, but you know, James was dealing with a lot. He was dealing with something that none of us were dealing with. And he pushed through all of that to become the great person that he is today and doing all the stuff he's doing today. So, shut up.
He is as committed to American democracy as any current elected official and would fight to protect the rights of all, including those who would use the power of their position to deny him his. I'm proud to call him friend. I can't think of a finer person to lead us into Washington, D.C.
What do you think it is to be an ally, to be kind of like a support?
To you, bro. Like, bro, you know I got your back. You see what I'm saying? People might say this, people might say that, bro. But before I even knew or anybody even knew about this and that, bro, we was like this. When you was going through stuff, bro, I was there. Nigga, we was there. We hung out, we went out, partied. Bro, we did everything that brothers is supposed to do. So, you know, I accept you for who you are, bro. Because you, for one, you're supposed to love thy neighbor. Like I said, it's a lifelong bond, bro. Shit, bro. Yeah, we in for the ride, bro.
So what would you say is the definition of an ally?
Just somebody who's going to treat you the same regardless, because it shouldn't really matter. I love going to kick it with James. He's a fun person to be around. And I was like, and you know, his personal life was his personal life. And, you know, it didn't matter. And that's how I feel like it should be for everybody, you know. I couldn't imagine anybody like being in my family and me trying to like shun them or be disrespectful of their way of life. I'm like, bro, this is my family. You know what I'm saying? You gotta love the people that you got around you, and they ain't gonna be here forever.
I think what I got from the movie Rustin, as somebody that's queer, is he was unapologetically brave. He was the type of person that would almost use this trait of like something that you would almost be embarrassed about And he used it to his strength. You know, he was the loudest person in the room. He was somebody that not only was somebody that needed allyship, but he was also an ally to others, you know. He was able to put on like the biggest march for the civil rights movement that gave Dr. King like a real platform.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the Civil Rights Act of 1964 passes like right afterwards. So it's like they both needed to like uplift themselves, and they really had to like, you know, have to have like real moral standing.
There was a scene in the movie where he said, "Don't kill a dream before it exists." And that's something I've been saying since I watched the movie. And I think this is, it speaks to this as well. Like, don't kill a dream before it exists. Like, and don't allow our organization, don't allow our community as Black men to stop before we can grow.
Based on this conversation, bro, that we had today, what do you think, or what do you hope that this spark?
In the end, I would hope that, you know, there's just more people that are confident in themselves and knowing that there are people inside their corner, you know, not everybody's alone.
Me just being me, I'm not looking to be a martyr at all. I just hope that me presenting myself as my authentic self shows younger brothers or younger men that are interested that you can be, because I didn't have that. It took for me to do research, and it took for me to have my own sound in mind. So if I can be just a spotlight for a second to show, hey, there are more than just one version of Omega, that's enough for me. Because it's by me existing, it allows for other people to exist more in the fraternity as the authentic self, and for them to find brotherhood within a brotherhood. Because, man, we are, I mean, the most amazing fraternity, if I do say so myself.